In this episode, we'll be looking at how we can create the illusion of height and depth on our surfaces using a method known as bump mapping. When we look at our camera reference, there's areas on the surface that are not completely flat, especially with the stippled effect we see on the camera body, in the way the sticker raises off the surface. During the modelling and sculpting process, you can actually create these surfaces using geometry. However, to achieve something as detailed as this would require a very high polygon count that will eat up computational memory if we were to import this prop into a game engine. So we can actually paint or create a grayscale image that takes the black, white and grey values and interprets them as the highs and lows of the surface here, and our shader is going to feed that back to us in the viewport once we plug our bump channel into the bump input. To create this bump map, there's a few methods we could use, and actually you should be familiar with most of them if you've been following along with the course. We could generate bump mapping using procedural layers, painting an image down onto the surface using the paint through tool, or manually painting with a paintbrush. There is another method we've not explored yet, which is copying layers. Copying layers allows you to reuse any paint data you've previously painted for other channels, such as the bump channel. The very first thing we need to do when we want to create a bump map is create a bump map channel. This is the channel that's going to be plugged into the bump slot of our shader. So open the channels palette and click Add New Channel. The drop-down at the top allows us to select previous channels created in our project that we can use as a template. I have some things stored here already because I was playing around earlier, but you might not have anything there, and we're going to go through the new channel process anyway, so we could ignore this drop-down. In the name field, we're going to enter the name of our new channel. Since we're making a bump channel, we can just call this bump. The size dictates the resolution of our channel. Our base color channel is 2048 by 2048. So let's make our bump channel the same. The higher the resolution, the more detail can be added, but it also impacts performance. 2048 by 2048 is going to allow us a suitable amount of detail for a game prop. The depth dictates the colour depth for our channel. 8-bit allows us 256 colours, which is enough depth for the kind of detail we need. The colour option lets us select a base colour for our channel, so we can leave that as default for now. When we create our new channel, a base layer is created using the colour defined here. Under the colour data options, we need to enable scale our data for our bump channel. If we have colour data turned on, it holds the RGB values that define the colour of the pixels in a texture. Scalar data, on the other hand, defines properties of the texture, such as shader inputs that define the bumpiness, roughness or shininess of the surface. Essentially, colour data exists to be seen, and scalar data is used to calculate. When creating masks, bump, roughness, normals, height and depth maps, make sure they're tagged as scalar. Click OK once you're happy and a new bump channel is created, which you can see in the channels palette. If you press and hold the I key in the viewport, you can also see the new channel in the channels column. If we head over to our layers palette, we can't see our base colour channel layers anymore, and we have a new set of layers for the bump channel. Let's hook this bump channel up to our shader so we can actually see what we're doing with it in the viewport. Open the shaders palette, and with principled BRDF selected in the shaders panel, click the empty button next to the bump input, and from the drop-down, select the new bump channel. The switch turns green to indicate there's an active input. And one more thing we may need to consider before we close this palette is under the Mari Surface tab, turn up the bump weight slightly to around 0.16, as the default weight may be a bit too weak in the viewport. This slider determines how much weight a bump map has. A lower value means smaller bumps, and a larger value means larger, more obvious displacements. We can adjust this at any time. We're going to focus on creating the stipple effect on the panels of our camera. If we could find a high quality, tileable grayscale image of this type of pattern, we could just load that in as a tiled procedural layer and mask off the areas we don't want it to affect. However, we don't have an image like that, and I think it could be more fun to create this effect using other procedurals. The effect we're after consists of small random cells that appear uniformly across the surface. The raised cells would need to be represented by the colour white, and the valleys between each cell would need to be represented by the colour black. This is how the shader interprets those colour values. We actually have a procedural available to us called cellular noise. We used this procedural to create the dust in the previous episode. When the cellular noise is set something bigger, it actually looks very similar to the noise we see on our camera reference. So let's do that. Let's remove the base layer from our bump channel as we don't need it by clicking the base layer and then clicking the remove layer button. Then add procedural layer, procedural noise cellular. Rename this layer to camera panel stucco effect or something you feel is recognizable. Reduce the cellular size to around 0.100. And if I hold the I key over the viewport and select the current paint target, we can see we definitely need to tighten up those cells if we want it to look anything like our reference, as currently they have too much of a soft blend on their edges. We also need to mask off the rest of the camera, as this effect only appears on the front and sides. Open the selection group palette, and if you set up the selection groups from episode 2, you should have a front, left, and right selection group set up for this effect. Hold shift and click each of those to select all the faces. If you didn't set up the selection groups, you can still follow along here by opening the selection groups Mari project, included in the course files. Then in our layers palette, right click the layer, layer mask, add mask from selection. Click the procedural icon on the layer to see our cells in the viewport again. Now our layer is applied to the appropriate areas, let's work on tightening up these cells to make them appear a bit more similar to our reference. Changing the cellular type to F2 to F1 helps a bit, as the type allows us to determine how the distance between each cell is generated, which in the F2 to F1 case provides a tighter edge on the cell. We want to keep the colour values black and white, as that's how the bump map is interpreted by the shader. If you're interested in checking out the documentation for the cellular node that expands on these inputs more, see our Learn site. We'll be using an adjustment stack on our cellular layer, like we did with the dust mask in the previous episode, so that we have a single layer with multiple adjustments. This just makes things a lot more manageable. Remember to switch back to the principled BRDF shader by holding the I key in the viewport. Right-click the cellular layer and click Adjustment Stack, Add Adjustment Stack, and let's add a levels to tighten up these black and white values and create more definition in the groove between each cell, so it's closer to our reference. With my levels layer selected in the adjustment stack, I'm going to check my current paint target with the I key. We can raise the black input to thicken the lines between each cell and bring the midtones down slightly so the white is more prominent. I'm switching back to the principled BRDF shader to check how my bump is looking, and I think it's looking pretty good. Remember to double check against your references and adjust your procedural layers and adjustment layers as necessary. You can also use the opacity slider on the stucco layer to reduce the effect if you feel like it's a bit too intense. Now we'll create some depth for the text around the camera and the Lomo logo so they don't look as flat, because in reality, these don't lie perfectly flat to the surface. The best way to do this is to take the layers we created for the lens text and logo in the base colour channel and copy those layers over to our bump channel. This means we're using the same paint information from the layers we worked on originally to create height for these painted elements. Head back over to our base colour channel, either in the channels palette or using the I key in the viewport, and locate the layers for the lens text and the Lomo logo. Right click one of those layers and select copy. Head into the bump channel layer stack and right click the top layer and select paste. If I look at this layer with the current paint target active, I can see there's some dark artifacts around the edges. We want to remove those dark spots so we have a clean bump. We need to go into the lens text layer in the bump channel and add a levels adjustment to this adjustment stack, just to lower the midtones and reduce the amount of dark spots in this image. Once we've done that, we have a clean white text that's being used by the shader to create depth in the lens text. Repeat the same steps with the Lomo logo. We need the image to be black so that the bump pushes out. So let's add an invert layer to the adjustment stack on the Lomo layer in the bump channel. If you're starting to find performance in Mari is taking a hit, you can speed things up by selecting the base shader under this menu here. These subtle bump techniques add much more texture and realism to your object. In the next episode, we're going to work on one of the most important parts of our camera, the lens, and make it appear glossy, transparent, and reflective.